How's it going, everybody? Travis Tooke here, and I'm super excited about today's show. I'm here with Anthony Martinez. Those of you that don't know Anthony, Anthony has been a student here since he was 5 years old, and he is currently 16, so he's been a lifelong martial artist. I'm not sure exactly what I'm asking yet. One of the questions I wanted to ask was what life was like before you did martial arts, but I feel like all your memories have formed since you started martial arts. So let's get started. How are you doing?
I'm pretty good.
Awesome.
I don't know where it's going to go today in regards to the conversation.
I'm going to ask you a lot of personal stuff that makes you uncomfortable.
that's what's going to make the best content.
No, but I want to talk about it because there are not a lot of kids who start martial arts at such a young age and continue with it into their pre-adult years and what seems to be, you know, something that you're going to continue for a very long time. Just tell us your thoughts on it. What has it been like?
Well, I know you mentioned those, like, that I started when I was five and that I've stayed with it now going on 11 years. But that's the case for a lot of people. We have very few people that stay for 10 years, achieve their black belt. We usually see around blue belts where it tapers off. But of course, that's your goal, to get everyone to black belt, to keep everyone for 10 years. And then for me to be starting when I was five and then keeping it until I was now 16, it's even more of an outlier. And I look back and I can't really discern what life was like before actually starting jiu-jitsu. I was 5 years old. Like, what was life when I was five? It was like,
that's why you wanted to be a dinosaur.
Yeah. Well, the thing is I started because I was watching Power Rangers. Like, my dad so wanted me to do baseball. I've told you this before, but I don't think I've told you the Power Rangers. Like, I would jump off the couch and, like, do a kick in the air. I wanted to do karate. I didn't know what jiu-jitsu was. I didn't know what wrestling was or anything like that. But Power Rangers, that's what I wanted to be.
And how close are you to achieving that goal at Team Tooke Mixed Martial Arts Academy?
I'd say closer than I was when I was five.
I'll take it. You know, I tell people you're a pretty unique individual, not just because of the martial arts. You have a maturity about you that is pretty uncommon. And I don't say this to flatter you or to be nice. It is what it is. You know, you're in pretty advanced classes in school. You do a lot of extracurricular activities. You compete in jiu-jitsu. You work here both administrative duties and teaching both little kids and older kids. A lot of responsibility. How do you do all that stuff? How do you put all that on your plate as a 16-year-old when most of your, you know, peers, at least among your age group, a lot of them tend to be more interested in having fun and doing some other normal high school kid activities?
Well, I do find all of that stuff very fun. So I guess that's still a continuity. But I would like to attribute it a lot to training. I can't not attribute to it. It's 70% of what my life is today. So I can look to when I was 5 years old. It was like, I had my parents, so that still would have been the same today. And the only really difference, if we go back and like sever my life from five and I take a different pathway, is Team Tooke. So a lot of the character development stuff that we have today, there was similarities in the program. And I, of course, it's all developed into something so big now and so much more impactful. But I want to say that just the character development of the program, just doing martial arts alone, really helped develop all of that. So I find joy in teaching because I like helping people, because that's developed over time of helping students in the class, being partners with someone that's new, someone that has their first day. And it's crazy. I still remember my first class so vividly as my first partner.
Really?
My first partner was Sophie. I'm sure you remember Sophie.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm still friends with her on, like, social media, and we stay in contact. She actually just graduated from A&M. But it's crazy to think about. It's like, she helped me so much on my first day, and I'm continuing that today. Sadly, she's not training anymore, but I'm continuing that. And then as for school, since I am teaching the kids' classes, I see it that I need to be what we tell them they should be. So if I'm practicing what I'm preaching. So I'm not doing schoolwork because I like it. I mean, I find it fun. I enjoy learning. I enjoy reading. But whenever I'm doing homework, it's not because I enjoy homework so much. But I understand the gravity that it has on not only my academics, but the image that I show to the kids that I teach, whether it be the 4 to 6 year olds or the 7 to 13 year olds.
You make a super strong point, and I think about that a lot. I feel the weight of my responsibility as an instructor when I make a lot of the decisions that I make. You know, if I'm in an irritated mood, or someone's bothering me, or I'm tempted to, you know, do something outside of my normal character, I feel like, well, don't do anything that might lead to a greater consequence that is unbecoming of a martial artist. Because, I mean, I'm a human. It's not, I don't think inherently we're, you know, just good or just bad people. I think we have all the qualities within us. It's the habits that we form and the actions that we take over time that mold us into what we become. But the idea that we're not tempted to either do not just bad things, but perhaps I would say not to live up to our potential, to maybe not work hard or just be lazier than we ought to be. As a martial artist, as an instructor, the idea that, well, I'm going to be the best teacher I can be, I have to push the students to go beyond their comfort zones. And it's hypocritical to do that without practicing that daily. So that's an excellent point. So doing martial arts for 11 years now, which is enough time to be a black belt, I would state you're not a black belt because of the age requirements in the system that we use. But in many other respects, you are a black belt, not only technically, but in the way that you carry yourself. What are some of your goals beyond this? I would say, obviously, I think earning your black belt is going to be one of them, but what are some of the bigger goals you have for yourself?
It varies, especially going through high school and finding different facets that I maybe have a brief infatuation with, but I do want to continue to help people. I think that plays a huge role in my life, and it's continued to do so, taking on different roles in either volunteering or here at the academy and teaching students, taking on my own classes. But it varies. I can't say definitively what I'd want to do from here, but I do want to pursue higher education, of course.
Well, talk about, you said volunteering. What do you mean by that? What are some of the things you're doing there?
This is actually a program that we've talked about a little bit before, and hopefully in the new year we'll bring this to our leadership students. But so around the beginning of high school, I started volunteering just with a couple of local organizations, a couple of elderly centers, and also group homes and anything like that. But I find it very important to look to the community around you to find growth. So we often see ourselves in situations that can feel like we can't get past them. And when you put yourself in a relative position to those around you and actually see what's going on and how good we actually have it, it's quite impactful. And not just that, but there's a lot of value in helping someone else, whether that be on your own accord or by accident, even if it's holding open the door for someone. There's a certain level of endorphins released by helping out someone else.
Yeah, no, I would agree. And I think that's why this line of work is so satisfying, is because you get to do that every day. And like anything can be taken for granted, I think, if you don't practice gratitude and set your mind right for that type of life. You can run through the day doing things that you should be grateful for and not being in that state of mind. So it's important that I think the way you start the day and end the day, you know, makes a big difference. But there's really no excuse not to be really invested in what you do when you love what you do. When you get to do the thing you're passionate about and help other people, there are a few avenues that are that satisfying, you know. All right, so I want to get into some more challenging questions, or I'll just use the word challenge to set up the question. Okay. What would you say are some of the bigger challenges to being a teenage instructor in a kids program?
Well, the 7 to 13 year olds, I originally thought it was going to be a difficult position to take. So the spot was open after one of the instructors. It was a change in the schedule. And then you approached me about taking on the class. Initially, I was just apprenticing underneath Professor Jose and helping out the classes. And then it kind of diverged into two separate programs where Professor Jose leads the leadership and I lead the fundamental program on Tuesday and Thursday. And I was worried. I was definitely worried. I was, I think, 15 at the time, so it's been close to a year now. But these are the kids that are 7 to 13. So 13, that's only 2 years away from what I was. And I'm not tall by any means. So I was worried that I was going to have students that were taller than me. And also that idea of who has the lead of the class. So challenging my authority based on my age was something that I was also worried about. But the crazy thing is, like, none of that happened. Like, I built a stronger rapport with the students just because we're so close in age. A lot of the instructors are 20s, 30s, but I think it's a little bit easier for me to... So most of the instructors, whether it be teachers or instructors here, they're around 20, 30, but significantly older than what a student might be, especially in the 7th to 13-year-olds class. So I find it a little bit easier to actually establish that rapport with them. And rather than a student-teacher... relationship, it becomes more of a friend relationship. But that continuity of authority and the recognition of my place as their instructor is still there.
Right. Well, you mentioned something that reminded me of a quote. I don't remember exactly what it is, but it's essentially, you know, I've been afraid of so many things in my life, or so many things have terrified me in my life, most of which, you know, I've never come true. So do you remember exactly what it is?
I don't remember exactly.
You know what I'm talking
is.
About,
yes.
Though, right?
Yeah, it's so true. It's
like 90% of the chaos in our brains that make us think, oh my God, what if this happens? What if they judge me? What if I fail epically? And in the end, you make mistakes, and almost no one's thinking about you that much, and it's forgotten about. And meanwhile, 90% of them never happen, and the 10% that do are forgotten about in hours to days, you know.
But it's important to understand, especially the outcomes to issues that arise that way. Like I said, that I had a lot of worries before teaching, but I'm so glad that I started teaching. So we have a propensity to not do something just because we're afraid of the consequences. And usually the consequences aren't as dire as we'd thought they'd be.
Right. Well, and I'll notice, and I don't know how much you've paid attention to your own personal growth over the years as a leader. Sometimes when we do things daily, we don't notice as much. It's almost like jiu-jitsu. We don't notice how good we're getting if our teammates around us are getting better. It's micro progressions along the way, and then one day we're a blue belt or a black belt, but we don't feel it's not overnight success. And I can recall a few moments when you led a class, an adult class, when I said, "Hey, Anthony, I want you to teach, or I want you to teach a move, you know, tonight. Teach a move," and I knew you were always game to do it. You know, you're always like, all right, like, let's do it. Because, you know, you read these books, you have a pretty clear vision about the kind of person that you want to be. But that doesn't eliminate the fear factor of doing something new or intimidating or speaking in front of your classmates who are all, many of them, double your age. And I don't know if you've noticed, if you remember this, but you used to do something that was almost like cute.
It's, yeah,
like,
I do remember.
You say, like, okay, guys, the next technique, we're going to grip here. And you'd pause, and you take like a nervous gulp, and it'd be like a 3-second pause. And I'm looking there, and nobody, like, noticed it. But I was like, oh, he's having a little, like, clear his brain moment there. Of course, now I feel like you can get up and just speak in front of 100 people during promotions, and it's as clear and eloquent as any of the other instructors. But you remember those
yes.
moments?
Yes. And, like, the way that feels in the moment is terrifying.
Totally.
Like, absolutely terrifying. And that doesn't just go away. Even with experience, public speaking, or speaking to anyone, really, you still have those moments. You're like, what am I going to say now? What do I have to do now? Oh, man, everyone's looking at me now.
Right.
I paused for too long. But in actuality, it was like 2 seconds have gone by and nobody's really paid attention, because what you're saying next is more valuable than the pause that you took.
Yeah. And then, so tell me if this was a coping mechanism also, because I felt like in a way, and I've done this too, is... after you had a moment where you explained something and it was maybe, you know, a little nerve-wracking, and then you would say, like, okay, does everyone understand? And then, you know, it's a bunch of adults.
Yeah.
They're just kind of nodding, like, yeah, we get it. You're like, I can't hear you. Does everybody understand? Like, military in general. And then everybody looks around and, it's commanding respect, but I think, maybe you do it for this reason. Sometimes I'll do that when I'm not feeling it. I feel like I can't just rise to just the energy that I need to be to get out of my funk or nervousness for the day. I need to soar past that and go into kind of like, it's almost like electroshock myself into getting in the moment, you know? And so I don't know if that was just, if you just felt energy or if you were like, man, I need to shake things up a little bit.
I would say it was a mechanism for getting past that. I think what it was is I became what I wanted the students to reciprocate so I can become what I wanted to become. Gotcha. So I put out this energy that in hopes that the students would reciprocate, and then that way I could actually be what I was striving to be. And that's the same today. Is like, I'll come in days and after school and I'm tired.
Right.
There's days that I'm sure you, Professor Jose, we just kind of don't want to be out on the mat. But that all changes once we go on the mat. We understand that that's our position. If we don't go onto the mats, no one's going to teach the kids. So we understand our role. And I think that's kind of how I get through it on those days.
Well, it's also what we teach the students is we know that they're not going to feel like practicing every day, but we expect them to make the drive, show up, get into class. And by the end, when sparring starts and everybody's mingling and you've got that human connection happening and you just got better at something, like I say, no one would ever reverse time if that were possible and skip the class that they forced themselves to come to. And we would never go back and say, oh, I wish I would have had the night off, even though it ended great with teaching. But there were 10 minutes when I was in a bad mood or I was a little off that day. We use the concept in the instructor course. We talk about, fake it till you make it, but it's not really faking. It's knowing there's a different truth that is not reflective of your current state of mind. So just understand, okay, you're not feeling it right now. Fine. You have a job to do. If you're a student, I don't feel like practicing. Fine. But you've made the decision to be a martial artist. That requires overriding your temporary emotions to get into that state of mind, you know? And I know for you, I know you've got a lot on your plate, and people would argue, oh, he's a kid. He doesn't have kids yet and he doesn't have a job. It's like, well, we all are at whatever levels we're at in life. If we take on enough responsibility, that's a lot on our current plate of life, you know? And I know you come in and it's like homework and test and college level credits that you're like, and you're always, I got a 94 on a test, Coach Travis. And like, it's fine. But you got a lot going on, but you still do the same thing. You just kind of snap and get out there and do it.
It's important to identify those roles, the role that we play to ourselves and the role that we play for others. I think it's best put as seek that which is meaningful, not that which is expedient. Yeah. So taking the path that of least resistance might be, might feel good. It might produce something that we might be happy with, but in actuality there's no growth that lies in taking that which is most expedient.
Agreed. And it's always much shorter lived. It just flees and then it's over with. So talk a little bit about what have been some of your biggest challenges with jiu-jitsu as a kid who moved into the adult class with people who are bigger, many of them more experienced than you. How did you maintain your optimism when much of your training during those times was other people getting the better of you? It's not like that anymore. That's why it's just way less fun to train with you than it was just a couple of years ago, because you've gotten so good. But, what was it like? How did you keep, because I've heard from, many students say, that sometimes that's a frustration. Oh, I'm smaller. The people are bigger than me. It's harder, or they're faster than me or this or that. And if I tell them, like, well, that's a challenge you can learn from and become great because of that that limitation. But not everyone, shares that mindset early on. And you seem to always embrace that.
It wasn't always like that. It's like, 2012, I was an orange belt. And I had been an orange belt for like three or four years before.
Right.
We can talk about that.
We didn't have our kids' ranking system very organized like we do now, so.
But I want to say 2 years of those 4 years was a plateau. I had reached a point where I was kind of complacent in where I was in my jiu-jitsu. I wasn't terrible, but I also wasn't living up to what I could be. So going back to that, what's expedient and what's meaningful, I was content with what I was doing and where I was at in my jiu-jitsu. And I think moving into the adult class reignited that and kind of began the exponential of my jiu-jitsu rather than continuing on that plateau. I don't know if I would say that it was much more difficult moving in because I was smaller. I think there's a degree of help being smaller and a degree of help being a little bit larger. But I think it's an inverse relationship of size and technique. So if you're a little bit bigger, going with someone a little bit smaller, technique might not matter as much. But for the person that's a little bit smaller, technique matters much, much, much more. So I think a focus on technique is really what I saw out of going with people that were a little bit old. Well, not a little bit older. Older.
Twice to four times your age.
Older, a stronger, heavier. But I'm glad I went through that. I wouldn't want to do that over any other way. And I think it's a valuable lesson to be learned, no matter if you're 200 pounds, 6 foot, or 5 foot and 100 pounds. There's a lot of value. In
at one point, I think you were 4 foot and 150 pounds, right?
Oh, yeah, we can go back on. Man,
it wasn't that big, but he was rather portly in his younger years.
Rather corpulent. God. You can go, man, once I'm 20.
Just go find my memories videos on Facebook, and you'll find a sweet little round kid named Anthony running around.
Yeah, once I'm 20, and those memories are going to still be coming around. I'm sure Facebook or whatever.
I'm going to make sure that video gets like a million views. It's awesome.
They'll continue to circulate. I'll ignore them, but they'll continue to be there. There's so much value in identifying what you're able to do, what your shortcomings might be, because we all have them, whether it be you're not as flexible as you'd like to be, or your cardio isn't quite where you'd like it to be. But there's so much importance to understanding what it is you're good at and what it is you can build on. And that's really how we develop our jiu-jitsu and make it our own.
Just one last thing I'd like to talk about. I feel like, you know, when I started jiu-jitsu, I was hooked on it pretty early on. I felt like there was never a moment where I really wanted to quit. And I don't know if that's true for you. I never saw a time where you were, you know, wanting to quit, or I had to talk to you about why you should stick with it. But for many students, that isn't the case. Many times they run into frustration or their schedule changes, or just sometimes for an adult, their schedule changes for 2 weeks and they get in the habit of, you know, taking those evenings off, and then the idea of getting back into it and working on those goals a little harder. For kids, I find that it's very common that they want to quit, and for very different reasons. They haven't thought it through like an adult. They thought it through like a child. Like, well, oh, I didn't have fun last time, so I kind of want to quit, or whatever the reason may be. And this is something we talk about when we discuss with parents. It's the conversation as well. What is your goal for your child? Is it for them to do something that's fun? Or is it for them to receive something that will improve their discipline, character, and confidence? After all, that's what you said in the beginning. So why are you giving in knowing that these results are, they're all happening, you know, right when they're happening? Sometimes that's when, like, oh, we want to take a break and I got to bite my tongue. But, you know, what are your thoughts on that with, you know, when you see kids go through the normal, you know, struggles of learning something new and then maybe wanting to quit just before they really start to gain the benefits of martial arts?
Man, this was something that I didn't understand for a long time. So when I was 12, I started joining in on the meetings with the rest of the staff. And you guys would talk about students that would quit. And I remember students that would quit when I started. Like, no one that I started with is still training. Professor Cameron is still around, but he was in the adult class. But we're like from the same era.
Yeah.
But it was completely lost on me, the idea that somebody would want to quit this. Mm-hmm. It's like, what do you mean? This is so awesome. Like, I would cry because I wouldn't be able to train some days. Like, if I couldn't come in on a like a Monday, Wednesday schedule in the early years for the kids program.
So you're a jiu-jitsu crack fiend just like me.
Yeah. I didn't quite understand why someone would want to stop training. I loved it so much, and for someone to want to stop training, and me, if I missed one training session, I was bawling. Something that I didn't really understand. And it took me a while to actually understand why. And it wasn't by my own accord. I did a lot of reading because I was really interested on why someone, specifically a kid, would want to stop doing something that I love so much as a kid. But that's just the nature of kids. We seek, like I said, that which is expedient. There's a certain degree of impulsivity that comes with childhood, and that kind of goes away as we socialize in the period, especially the Little Champions period. So we have our 4 to 6 year olds program, and that's where you see it the most, where parents come either asking myself or Coach JP questions on either their child's growth or saying that their kid doesn't want to do it anymore. And that was something that I really wanted to learn about. So I looked at it from a lot of psychological books about the development of children, and they talk a lot about the different parenting styles. So I think it's a great shift that parents want to help their kids. So they don't want to be the authoritarian parent. That's the name for someone that is, what was it? High responsibility and high repercussions for disobedience. So the opposite of that, on not really a spectrum, but rather a chart, is the permissive parent. So the low expectations, no consequences. And that doesn't goad successful children either. But it's important to understand that in between that is the authoritative parent. So you understand that standards are welcome, especially for a child, and it's important to the development and the socialization in the period from 4 to 6. That's why I enjoy teaching that class so much. It's a much greater impact than a lot of people would give it credit, especially contrasting an adult class and a 4 to 6 year old class. I know you've taught a couple of the 4 to 6 year old classes, but
they're a different animal for sure. No, and what I what I try to remind parents, and I'm not an expert on the subject matter, but I think this statement rings true, is that I'll say it from my perspective. I have to be the coach first and the friend second. My responsibility is to make sure that you understand what I'm teaching, whether that be the techniques or the character skills that are associated with the martial arts that we teach. Now, I'm not here just to always make you happy, but to make sure that you are growing as a martial artist. And I think for parents, it's the same thing. It's like, well, you're never going to get your kids to always like you unless you just give them everything you want. And then that's really not genuine. Kids will find a way to manipulate when possible. That's human nature, especially as a child. I sometimes try to tell the parents and the coaches, it's like, hey, all the character skills that we're teaching young children, they're not going to have a sense of greater good for a while. It's just forming habits. Later, when they become more mature, then they start to connect the habits with a better life and becoming a better citizen, a better person for the world, in general. But that's sort of how it is. Parenting and coaching, I think, are very similar in respect to the responsibility of each role. You're there to be the parent first. And that sometimes means putting your kids in situations that involve a certain amount of stress that they have to overcome. Not, like you said, the parent that's overbearing or, to a higher degree, even abusive. That's more damaging than good. But allowing your kid to struggle, it's like in school. They don't want to go to school every day. They don't want to do homework. But by going through these challenges, they become more resilient. So when college comes around, when the, you know, when employment in the future comes around, and just when life comes around, marriage and taxes and bills and all the things that nobody ever wants to do, we accept these as normal challenges that we must take part in and accept. And so I think that's really the real essence of martial arts, is becoming a person who can handle the challenges that life throws at you. And I think every training session offers the opportunity, to get a little bit stronger in that area.
And none of that comes as a consequence of just being. So if you're not going to turn 21 and automatically understand how you're going to live the rest of your life, and having not done anything preceding that time. So a lot of the time, like I said, the parents will say that their kid doesn't want to do it anymore. It's not consistent with what they tell their kids in other facets of their life, though. I think the best example, whenever parents say that, is a school. Right. If your kid doesn't want to go to school, you're not going to keep them home. Or it's not illegal. I mean, it's not legal. Yeah. But
I wonder how many might do that if it was like, well, he doesn't have to, but I can't get arrested.
Yeah. But we value education. We value education because we see that as a child gets older, that plays a valuable role in adulthood. And I think the same should be applied, not only martial arts. I know we're biased because we love it so much, but to really anything, whether it be a sport or anything that you're applying yourself to. If you have the opportunity to just give up on it at any moment, it's not worth
it. It's habit forming. Yeah, absolutely. We got a bunch of students here, and they're kicking the bag, so I feel like we need to wrap this up soon. I feel like we could talk about this subject for another hour easily. We'll definitely have to do a follow-up video, but man, I thought this went really well. Super happy to make this happen. Thanks for being here, and I'll see you guys for the next one. Hey, thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed that, please be sure to like and subscribe to this channel. Also, don't forget to share this video with somebody else. Thank you.